I'll call the meeting to order. Roll call, please.
Mayor Rankin?
Here.
Vice Mayor Walter?
Here.
Councilmember Woolridge? Councilmember Hawkins?
Here.
Councilmember Galeen?
Here.
Councilmember Anderson?
Here.
Councilmember Wall?
Here.
We have a quorum.
As we get ready to talk about our budget, we need all the help we can get from whoever we can get it. So as we stand for a minute of silence, keep us in mind, please. And then we'll go into the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. This will be the call of the public for public comment on issues within jurisdiction of the town council.
I can see it.
Council rules limit public comment to 3 minutes. Individual council members may respond to criticism made by those commenting, may ask staff to review a matter raised, or may ask that a matter be put on a future agenda. However, members of the council shall not discuss or take any action on any matter during an open call to the public unless the matters are properly noticed or for discussion and legal action. Lisa, do you have any cards?
I do not, sir.
Is there any member of the public who would like to speak at this time before we go into our regular meeting? Seeing no movement, I'll close call to the public. New business.
Item A, resolution number 1523-15. Discussion approval, disapproval of a resolution of the Town of Florence, Pinal County, Arizona, granting a non-exclusive utility easement to Arizona Public Service Company and authorizing the execution by the town manager of supporting documents. Mr. Eckhoff?
Mayor, council, good afternoon. The three items that we have on the agenda regarding A, B, and C, those are formalizing agreements and easements that are necessary for the development, the ongoing development of the project across the street. One is for APS to continue to provide electrical services to the property. One is for Southwest Gas, and then the other is also formalizing the new alignment of the skid canal on the property. I'd be happy to provide any additional details or elaborate upon those, but all the work with all those items, as you can see, is proceeding. It's ongoing. These things are being done as we talk. This is just a formality that's necessary to get these easements recorded and formalized.
Thank you. Any member of the council have any questions? Hearing none, I need a motion.
I'll make a motion that we adopt resolution 1523-15, granting a non-exclusive utility easement to the Arizona Public Service Company for the Territory Square project.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to adopt resolution 1523-15. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Item number B, resolution number 1524-15, discussion approval, disapproval of a resolution of the Town of Florence, Pinal County, Arizona, granting a non-exclusive utility easement to Southwest Gas Corporation and authorizing the execution by the town manager of supporting documents.
Same thing, Mark?
Same thing.
Same thing. Any other questions from the council? Seeing none, I need a motion.
I'll make a motion to adopt resolution number 1524-15, granting non-exclusive utility easement to the Southwest Gas Corporation for the Territory Square project.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to adopt resolution 1524-15. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Item C, resolution number 1525-15, discussion approval, disapproval of a resolution of the Town of Florence, Arizona, granting an easement for irrigation improvements to the United States of America Bureau of Indian Affairs San Carlos Irrigation Project and authorizing the execution by the town manager of supporting documents. Mr. Montoya?
Same thing, Mark? Same thing.
Actually, any other questions? If I may, real quick.
Oh, go ahead.
I definitely want to thank Mark for drafting a lot of these and getting these all together in short notice. And definitely want to thank Mr. Richard Morales from APS for assisting us. And also thanking you for intervening on our behalf for SCID, SCIP, and BIA. So, thank you.
Thank you. Ben. Any other discussion? Need a motion?
Make a motion to approve resolution number 1525-15.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to adopt resolution 1525-15. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Item D is for discussion and approval of the Greater Florence Chamber of Commerce application for a special event liquor license for the first Thursday event on July 2nd, 2015 at McFarland State Park. This is just the regular liquor license that they come and get each month for the first Thursday's event. I'm sorry, I think I said first Friday, it's first Thursdays.
Okay. Any questions, Lisa? Need a motion?
I'd like to make a motion to approve the application for the Greater Florence Chamber of Commerce special event license for the first Thursday Chamber event on July 2nd at McFarland Park.
Any other discussion? Oh, I need a second.
Second.
We have a motion and second to approve the Greater Florence Chamber of Commerce application for a special event license for the first Thursday event on July 2nd, 2015 in McFarland State Park. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for the question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Work session. I guess we're going to get to work session now.
Okay, Mayor, Council, if I may. I have a quick, about seven slides I want to run through, and then I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Farina to go do a recap on a summary. And then we'll start going through the budget and seeing where council's at and seeing what questions you all may have. First of all, this is it's a streamlined budget for the most part. It's not like the last few years we have a lot of things that we added into it. We basically kept it straightforward with what we went to the voters with, those capital projects in each of the major areas of town, that some of them are one-year projects, some of them are two-year projects. We'll go through that later. We did not add any new positions in this budget. We actually have a number of positions that are frozen. And as we continually go through the budget, not just this year, but next year, we're going to still have to look at strategic positions, whether or not they play a role in affecting direct service delivery and see if we need to hold those or what we're going to do, and based upon a number of things. Second of all, in this budget, there is no vehicle purchases. There is no vehicle replacements. There's nothing like that. And the last item I want to run through is items of concern that will come up either in this next budget year or in the years to come. If you all remember this one from 2013, and then we did this again, I'll show you the slide last year, the use of fund balance over the years, our goal was to bring it down in 2015-16 to zero. A number of things have changed. If we go through where we're at now, in 13-14, we did stick to using $865,000 in fund balance. However, we didn't use any of that. We returned approximately $450,000 back to the general fund. In 15-16, we adopted $469,000. I think this year we're going to be estimated to use it for the first time ever, maybe about $150,000. In 2015-16, we're looking at $1.1 million of fund balance uses. That is for a number of reasons. That number originally, I believe, was over $2 million the first time the budget committee had it. The last issuance was about $1.7 million. Our goal was to get that under $1 million. There's a number of items in there, and we'll go through that. But one of the increases, about $100,000, was our liability insurance. Over the next year, over the next few years, there's a number of things we're going to have to do. We're going to have to watch vehicle replacements and purchases, just not do them unless we absolutely need to. Maintain vacant positions that are strategic, that don't affect service delivery. Merit increases, if they're included in the budget, need to be one time. We're trying not to add to the base budget so that we're not restricted as bad and we can keep down the use of fund balance. We need to look at controlling overtime in all the departments. Limit operating cost increase to those that are uncontrollable, like electric and gas, those things we don't have control over. As I said, manage additional vacancies. We have to look at property tax. This year, we did not come to council proposing a property tax because of how the election fell and where the calendar was. We really did not have time to do all the necessary paperwork that we needed to do to even recommend an increase in property tax. But that is something Excuse me. That is something we definitely need to look at, as this year the state made some changes. Hang on. This year the state made some changes that took away from the town's property taxes and the county's, and therefore brought our usage down, our property tax. Even though our mill levy rate did not change, it reduced the amount of property tax. And then at some point in the future, when we need to look at new roads or utility projects, we probably need to start looking at bonding, therefore saving some of that fund balance for future use. You all may recall, we went to the voters here a few months ago and asked for expenditure limitation and grant us an additional $15 million to go ahead and move forward with the 2015-16 budget. At this point in time, this budget is under by just over $4.4 million. So while we asked for $15 million, we're looking more about $11 million right now. After the budget committee looked at the amount of fund balance that was being used, we went back and asked the departments to look at their individual line items and cut an additional percentage points from each of their budgets. When those came back, we also looked at actuals from 13-14 and reduced them even more. So this budget has been cut a number of times. What we've tried to do is not impact service delivery. We tried to, when we went out, we told the citizens we were not going to impact service delivery. We tried not to do that. However, I will say in a slide or two, I'll show you that after all we did, we need to look at some changes, some slight changes. These are the road projects that we went to the voters with when we talked to them in individual areas throughout the entire town. You'll see there are 4 one-year projects. Those projects are fairly straightforward, fairly simple, and will get done in this first year. They're straightforward in meaning they don't need a lot of engineering or design work. The other projects, these are budgeted in 2-year increments. This is the first year only because it's going to take us time to do the RFP, the request for proposals, to get vendors in here, then to do engineering and design work. And it's going to take us a lot of the year in order to do that. So I wanted to make sure you all knew that some of these projects are 2-year projects. As I said before, there are items of concern. The first one is a SAFER grant. That grant expires in March. This budget includes the additional three months for funding that third position on the fire truck up there in the Anthem area. However, we're going to try and apply for a grant extension, but we can't do that till the federal fiscal year opens in October 1. And then the awards come out normally around January, February. So that is an unknown on how that will work. Additional state revenue reductions. This last legislative session, we heard that the property tax reduction was going to be considerably more. But we also know they're looking at state shared revenues. They're looking at population base that affects colleges and communities that have prison population. The Santana Corporation, and I do have a handout here for you all, that was done back in 2009, 2010, and Jess can help me later if you guys have questions on it. The potential effect. This last legislative session, the staff spent a considerable amount of time on the phone, off and on at the legislature, with our lobbyists, trying to get a handle on the incorporation. The original incorporation was approximately 80,000 people that they were looking at a few years back. That would probably affect the town anywhere from $800 to $1 million annually. What we tried to do is say, hey, you know, if you're going to do it anyway, do it small. Do it 12,000, but we have no control over that. So we've just been trying to control it as it moves forward and try and talk to our legislators and everything we potentially can do with our partners here in Pinal County. The annexations. I have a handout for you on annexations if you guys are curious later that shows the cost of those annexations and if they come into the budget, if council continues to pursue them, or if the court basically denies the annexation request, how it could potentially affect us if we bring those on. The Florence Copper Project. That is in the general fund. In previous years, the last 2 years, it was located in the capital fund. Because it is a one-time expense in council, it's really up to you on a year-to-year basis whether or not you want to continue this. It is in the general fund, and it does play a role to the tune of about $250,000 in that fund balance use. Unknown emergencies. You may recall about a month and a half ago, we had a well go down in North Florence. We have had, I don't know, a handful of water pipe ruptures this last year. Those are things we cannot anticipate. At this point in time, the utility budget, while it does have funds set aside for it, we have not isolated specific projects for a number, two reasons, basically. The first one is we really need to do an updated study on what projects need to be and what those impact fees are going to be. And two, we need to look at our infrastructure once again and see where we're at with that. Sales tax collections, they're down slightly this year. We don't exactly know where they're going to be next year, so we took a conservative approach. The committee took a very conservative approach. We do know that there are at least two additional restaurants opening up in town probably in the next 6 months, and so we don't know how that's going to affect us. Home building activity. It continues to go up and down. I believe for the last 3 months, Pulte is at 20-plus homes, new home permits monthly. And then the upcoming elections. We got to go through the expenditure limitation again, beginning of next year, April, May, and then we have the general election in the fall. Items for additional consideration. When we originally did this budget, we were looking at a lot of the line items, and the overtime was a big concern, but it was also the part-timers. Inadvertently, I believe we removed $40,000 too much. Matter of fact, the chief, talked to me about it and said, based on the plan that we're doing, he needs that $40,000 back in line in that budget in order to operate correctly and not affect service levels. So that is one thing we're asking for. Community development. And talking to Mr. Eckhoff, there is basically, we need the building inspector because all the home permits, the commercial permits have pretty much doubled over the last few years. Our current building inspector is inundated. There is going to be basically a wash. There was an additional administrative person that will be shared between community development and the town engineer. And then Mr. Eckhoff will be eliminating the additional contracts expenditures that he uses for Wildan to do inspection stuff so that he can get the building inspector back if council will allow him to do that. Moving forward, we do need to look at developing a long-range financial plan, at least a plan that goes not only 1 but 3 and 5 years. We got to update the capital improvement plan, and as I said before, we need to do a utility rate study. There also may be a number of other things we need to do. So for that, I'm going to turn the review for the summary over to Ms. Farina.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. What I'll do is pretty much go over the highlights that are in your budget book. I think it's like the second page. And really what I highlighted here are the various impacts or changes to the budget compared to last year, that, and then a dollar amount to those changes. So first of all, the first one is House Bill 2617 that was passed, and which really the town had no really say so in it. Now we're going to be starting getting billed by the state for TPT collection administration. So that impacted our budget by $56,000. We, as council approved several meetings ago, there was the addition of a town engineer, a town engineering department, and then there was also the engineer department that we already had. That was moved into HERF because it serves streets, so we've moved that out of the general fund and into the HERF fund. And then the town engineer department was created, and that's allocated between the general fund, the HERF fund, the water and sewer funds. I'm sorry, I started on the second page. Thanks, Jess. So going back to the first page, in case I had you confused, organization-wide, this budget, as Charles said, it's a 3% average merit-based stipend. It's not a salary or base level salary increase. It would be a stipend amount so as to not increase the level of salaries heading into the next year's election for home rule. Again, so that way we wouldn't have that increase affecting our expenditure limitation for next year should the election not pass. Thankfully, as it has already been reported to council, there was no increase in health insurance premiums. So just assuming an 8% increase, that really helped out the, not just the general fund, but across the board, all the other funds, savings of about $179,000 had we seen an 8% increase. And then with the election passing, no reduction in service levels. In the general fund, when we built this, when we first started, we developed two budgets, a pass scenario and a fail scenario. In the fail scenario, you may remember we were talking about setting the budget at the 13-14 actuals. The election passed, and what we were projecting or using as a base for the 14 or 15-16 budget was the 14-15 budget levels with a 1.5% escalation for inflation. So that was part of this, and then as we were looking at, in particularly in the general fund and the use of fund balance, we wanted to get that use of fund balance down, and we made other reductions off of the 1.5% increase to the 14-15 budget. There's several positions that have been frozen and will remain frozen, one in part because we don't know the results of the election for the home rule for next year for the 2016-17 budget, and also having to do with the general fund and use of fund balance. So the administrative position is frozen, administrative assistant position was frozen in administration. In the budget committee, we also talked about, and I think council may have talked about it as well, outsourcing the town magistrate, and that's a decrease of $23,000. The assistant town attorney position is frozen, and continuing professional services for continued outside legal services for the Florence Copper project. In finance and grants, that first one, that should not be there. Right now, the plan is to hold that vacant. However, it's still in the budget, you know, depending on how the workload is as the winter residents start to return. Because what the fail scenario had was having that position frozen because we were going to outsource sanitation, and that position was added as a part of the sanitation being outsourced to handle the billing. However, with the election passing and keeping sanitation with the town, at least as this current budget is set, that position could be used for that purpose. However, it will be held vacant until further notice. So even though it's in the budget, reflected in the budget, the numbers, that position will be held vacant.
Excuse me, Mike, can I just make a clarification on that?
Sure.
You offset this cost with the sanitation fund, don't you?
Cost?
Right.
Right, there's a sanitation and admin fee, is that what you're referring
to?
No,
I'm saying that for this position, it's offset by sanitation, isn't it?
Yes, most of this position is in, only 10% of this position is in the general fund. The remainder does come out of the sanitation and also even some of the utility accounts.
Right, so it's actually not an increase, it's basically more or less a wash except for that 10%.
Correct, I think that is about $8,700.
Okay, thank you.
The grants coordinator position has been frozen. That's been frozen for quite a while now. And then, you know, as we were looking at the grants manager and assessment, grants and assessment manager, the duties actually have not been reflective of what the budget had. So the majority of that salary was added back to the general fund, whereas it used to be charged to the CFDs. However, the amount of work that position was doing for the CFDs did not equate to the percentages, so it now more accurately reflects what that position actually handles. Community development, Charles spoke about that. Right now, it is reflected as a frozen position in this budget that you have. However, Charles mentioned that it's something to be looked at. In the police department, a dispatcher position is frozen, and as well as the police officer position that was added last fiscal year, the school resource and crime prevention position. Fire department, elimination of a temporary captain assignment, And also, as Charles mentioned, as Mr. Montoya mentioned, the SAFER grant expires. This reflects that. So with this SAFER grant expiring in February, March, when the general fund has to start picking up is reflected in this budget. Position frozen in information technology. In parks and recreation, this budget reflects parks maintenance for the new sports fields and grounds to the facility to the west of Town Hall. It also reflects an increase for the community center or the building itself, the cost to maintain that building. It also reflects new aquatic center costs. And staffing for the new community center, as well as an addition for Road to Country Thunder. Our expenditures for this year ran about $16,000, so that was added to this budget for next year, too, if council desires to continue that. Now, back to the second page. Again, House Bill 2617, I've explained, in the Town Engineer Department. The next one would be the Capital Projects Fund. The capital projects total $2.6 million for this year in the capital projects fund, and in the highway user revenue fund, $1.1 million. Again, some of those are two-year projects, and then there's the one-year projects that are also reflected in this budget. The detail is within those specific funds that shows what the detail is, and Charles also had a slide as to what those projects were. There's also a maintenance worker one or several maintenance worker one positions frozen, two full-time and one half-time position. In the fleet services fund, a mechanics assistant position has been frozen. In the facility services fund, there is a added custodian position to handle the custodial services for the new community center. In the water utility fund, you know, and also the sewer utility fund, a systems operator position has been frozen. It's split half water, half sewer. Also, as a highlight, there's funds in the budget for a rate study for utilities. And as well, for capital projects, we don't have specific capital projects identified in the water and sewer funds. However, there's a placeholder, so if and when a rate study is completed and also a new capital improvement plan, then those projects could be identified in those two funds. Also, in the utility funds, there's a, with the last rate study, there was a schedule set forth for, I think it was about 5 years, for recommended rate increases. However, at the budget committee level, we talked about those rate increases and decided, you know, let's hold off on those rate increases for this coming year that are scheduled or recommended in the last rate study that the town did, and so that way we can do a new rate study as well as a capital improvement plan. In the Transportation Development Impact Fee Fund, there were funds in that, and to help fund projects that we have for this year or for this coming year, 2015-16, in the HERF fund. It's proposed that $955,000 is transferred out of the transportation impact fee and into the HERF fund to reimburse the diversion dam project that we have going now. That was a project that was identified in the development impact fee study that was completed back in 2012 or 13, I believe. So it is a project that was approved for the infrastructure improvement plan, and there was $955,000 in the transportation impact fee fund for that. The Merrill Ranch CFDs, GO bond placeholders, that's for an item for council to discuss in the future with the CFD, or for the CFD board to discuss. But in order, you know, since we're approving a budget, we're putting those numbers in there as a placeholder, not to say that there will be GO bonds issued. They're just in there as a placeholder if the board so chooses to issue those bonds. The same for the special assessment lien bonds. There's two areas in CFD number one and one area in CFD number two. I have a cut and paste error there, so that under CFD number two should say issue SA lien bonds unit 36, not 50 and 53, because that's for CFD number one. You know, a couple other things that Charles mentioned was, we need to do a capital improvement plan and also a long-range financial plan and that will help the town, you know, just ensure that, you know, as right now, there is a drawdown of the general fund, and we talked at length in the budget committee that a need for a long-range financial plan. I don't believe that the town has ever done one, but that's a plan that, you know, a lot of municipalities do to make sure that as you're making decisions, you're able to look back at what your projections are over the years, over the next 5 years, could be a little longer, but, you know, usually it's five, and then you can kind of see where your fund balance is over those 5 years as you're starting to make decisions that affect the future. So, you know, for example, you could have a long-range financial plan that some of the issues that Charles talked about, for example, Santana annexation, you could have a scenario that if this passes, what are we going to do? So you put together a long-range financial plan that looks at different scenarios, but then also shows that you have an understanding where you're going in the future and maintaining the healthy fund balance. So with that, one more thing. In the capital projects fund and the highway user fund and also the utility funds, this budget does not reflect any carry forwards yet. I'm kind of waiting until the last minute to input those so I know exactly, well, not exactly, but as close as I can know as to where we're at on the projects to date so I can carry forward funds into the next fiscal year. It's my belief that any carry forwards of projects will not impact the expenditure limitation. And with that, that concludes my presentation, and myself, Charles, and the rest of the department directors are here to answer any questions.
Okay, I'd like to start out with my budget committee making any comments that they have so that the rest of us know what you think of what we've just gone through.
Well, for myself, we did quite a bit of work on the budget, and at this point, we need to be very conscious, especially in the general fund, of expenditures. From what I'm seen in the last couple of years, everything that was budgeted basically was spent except for a small amount of money. We need to monitor the expenditures on a continuous basis. That's how we used to do it. They need to come in as close as possible to the revenues that we're generating, and we lost some revenues this last year whenever we lost our library funding, et cetera. You also lost some property taxes. So you cannot continue to escalate the expenditures and lose revenue. Either you create new revenue or you compress your expenditures. That is a major component of this. You cannot continue to utilize fund balance. There is a certain amount of fund balance that was saved over the years. It was quite a bit of money. But if you continue to accelerate your expenditures without accelerating the revenue, you're going to deplete those fund balance and you will not be able to sustain. So I believe that we need to put in a plan of possibly doing more with less, looking at all of the departments and how they're functioning, just like we've done in the past. There's no chemistry to it other than it's a very simple procedure. You cannot spend more money than you're generating. John?
Well, I just will thank Becky for all her expertise because she can say it much better than I can. But so that people understand, this year we are over our income by $1,161,000, but we're spending more than we're taking in. And that says we do not have a balanced budget this year. And so far, we haven't seen a plan as to how we're going to get back to a balanced budget. As Becky says, we need to either figure out a way to increase revenues or we're going to have to compress our expenditures. I think that's the most important thing that we need to face right now. So far, we haven't addressed that. I'm a little disappointed in that part of it.
Well, that's what we're here for. That's you guys in the budget committee. I want to thank you very much for the time you put in for it. That's when I was mayor before, that's when we instituted the two council members being on the budget committee. And I think it's very valuable for all the members to have at least one shot at it during their term in office to understand what is going on a little bit better than what we have. Addressing the 1.2 million that John brought up, is that what the number you pointed out?
Yeah.
Now that's from what we've got budgeted at this point, that's over anticipated revenues coming in. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Mike?
Yes, that use of fund balance that's in this recommended budget draft, the $1,161,000 that Councilmember Anderson referred to is expenditures exceeding revenue. However, that is not a recurring amount that if you continued on this path, it wouldn't continue to stay that way because that also reflects an amount of $250,000 that would not be annually recurring. It's currently, I mean, I don't know how many more years it would continue, but it's related to the Florence Copper. Right. So let's, if not counting that, it's use of fund balance of about $911,000. If, I mean, we're using this year $1,161,000, however, $250,000 of that is more like a one-time expenditure.
But I would like to point out that we also have cut back all the capital expenditures this year. You know, there's no equipment, no new equipment in here, no raises in here. So what's going to happen to us next year and the following years?
I do want to make a comment on capital expenditures, especially on vehicle replacement for our public safety. You can only do that for a very short period of time, maybe 1 or 2 years. For the amount of miles that these vehicles travel, the number of people that they have in their departments, in order to compensate for that, you will have to spend a large amount of money on fleet maintenance, and you don't want to get in that position down the road where your vehicles are aged 10 years or more and you have a fleet that is in constant need of repair. So that's only a short-term fix, but you have your capital projects fund where money flows in there, that is a designation for that money to be spent on any type of capital need for the town over $5,000.
Still going to the overage, the anticipated overage. How much are we going to be able to, what do we have now in fund balance available?
This budget shows at the end of the fiscal year 2015-16, there's still a $7 million ending fund balance. After reserves, it's $5.1 million. GFOA recommended best practices to have an ending fund balance, minimum being 2 months worth of expenditures. This ending fund balance after reserves is well over that two-month recommendation.
That is not a good fund balance. Even though it's recommended that way, we are far from being anywhere close to under control with that.
By controlling our expenditures this year, we can raise that fund balance, shouldn't we?
Yes.
Even though we're going to have to use some of it.
Yes. But we do need a plan for the future years, and we need to be working on that continuously. I know it's not fun to have to cut positions or to cut expenditures in the departments, but we've had to do it before. It's the only way that you can compensate for no additional revenue, and I don't see at this point in time where you're going to be getting additional revenue from.
So the revenue we're getting in, we're going to have to pay, if you want to call it a tax to the state, for them to collect that tax and give us out. So
right. Well, basically, they're charging you for doing a service. You will be getting increases in future years on your state shared revenues. That's a given. But you have to make sure that your expenditures come more in line with that. We don't want to start using $1.15 million or $1.5 million every year because that's your fund balance that you're going to have left at the end of next year will be gone in 3 to 4 years.
And I agree with you on partially. I think we do need to control our expenditures, and I've already express that concern to the town manager and to Mike that this coming budget we're going to have to really watch our you know, get down to your pennies, nickels and dimes. We're going to have to do that. Department heads, you're going to have to do the same thing to help us out in order for us to come back. We spent a lot of money this year, but look what we've accomplished. I think it's well worth the money that we spent to accomplish what we have got. I really do. I take a look at what we got going. Now, let me ask you, Mike, how much are you anticipating in here of sales tax money coming in?
Our projected number for 15-16, you can see, is projected lower based on the current trends, at $2.5 million local sales tax. In 2014-15, we had projected 2.6, so we revised that based on the current trends, but also based on the new restaurants. $2,564,000 is what's in this budget.
So that's what you're hoping that we get in from the state?
No, I'm sorry. That's the town's local sales tax. That's the 2% that the town collects from the state. Those numbers, we receive projections from the Arizona League of Cities, and the state shared sales tax is about $2.4 million. The state shared income tax, which that number is usually right on with the state, is almost $3.1 million. And then the vehicle license tax is $1.3
million. And you're on page two?
I'm on page four.
Okay.
And it's the fourth section of the revenues. Intergovernmental.
Well, I guess the one thing that I've got to say to the council is on property taxes, let's do everything we can to stay away from having to increase. We're seeing what outrages are occurring in the school districts. They weren't able to pass their bond. CAC now is going to be increasing theirs. $732,000, what percentage is that of all the revenues anticipated coming in?
Looks like about 5%.
What?
Around 5.
5% of our budget is generated from property tax. And I think if we can keep it in that area, that we'll be in good shape. The state, what else did they hit us on as far as we have to be concerned with the budget on this year? We know that they got us on having to pay for the sales tax collection.
Right, and then also the property tax. This budget reflects $113,000 reduction in property tax. Now, those are estimates that were put together by another city and shared with the various towns within Pinal County. So the number that they showed us was about $113,000, and that was done by one of their consultants. So we took that number and subtracted it from our budget. Do I know the exact number that it's going to be? No, those are just the numbers that a consultant was paid to come up with.
So it's $113,000 you're anticipating losing?
That's correct.
On HERF money, we also lost money there too, correct?
Not for this year that I'm aware of. Not in 15-16. It might have been in the past where those numbers have been reduced, but I don't recall a bill or anything coming out of this year that would reduce next year's.
So we're okay on HERF at this point?
Yes.
Now, in the amount of money that we put into the budget for the roads for next year, we know that's not all going to be spent, I would assume. Is that correct?
Mayor, Council, that is correct. What we did on the project list is we basically broke it down, and I can print out a list of how we did it. The ones that were on that list that show one time, those are most likely going to be all spent, the ones that say one-year project, because they don't need a lot of engineering and design work. The other ones are going to need to be RFP'd out. Those need to find an engineer or design. Those are going to be probably take up, and I would defer to Wayne, but my assumption is about 8 months of the year. And then we'd have to look at the construction costs, which we did split it out into 2 years. So this is approximately, Mike, about 25%, correct, of the major project, somewhere around there?
It varies by project, but that's a good estimate.
And the remainder that is put in year two to make sure that we can construct those projects.
So we're not going to be taking that money to supplement other portions of the town budget. We're going to be utilizing that money for what we have planned for the engineering and so forth, with a rollover for next year to go into the construction phase of it. Is that what I'm listening to?
That is correct.
attorney.
Mike, I noticed that you changed the income on the aquatic center.
John, what page you on?
Page 6.
Mike, if we're going to different pages in the book, let's make announcement which page it is. I said council can follow with you.
Okay, sorry.
No, I hadn't even thought about it. I was going to tell you and I forgot.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Okay. You originally had about $90,000 income from the pool. I noticed you dropped that down now to about $60,000.
That's correct. Those are the numbers that we discussed in the budget committee that we should reduce them to try to be a little more conservative on our budget projections for those revenues. But at the time we were discussing in budget committee, we felt that the original projections were high, so we reduced them.
Okay.
Brian, have you heard anything from the Arizona SEALs on the project of them coming on board with us on the aquatic center?
Mayor, council members, they're very interested. They're actually using the community pool right now, but they just wanted to get going with the summer before we kind of sit down and kind of nail down an agreement. But I think they definitely want to be permanent tenants at the pool, and I think we can work something out. And that revenue is not reflected in here right now.
So the savings and that we may generate on lifeguards and so forth, is that along with any revenue generated by the Arizona SEALs that we have a contract with or however we're going to work it out, that'll be coming to us at a later date?
Correct.
And then also we're going to be doing, I would assume, an IGA with a school or something on shared use facilities with some of their equipment and in our pool?
Correct. I have a meeting with the assistant superintendent on Friday to discuss that.
This Friday?
Correct.
Now, is that just for Florence or is that for Florence and Poston Butte?
As of right now, we are just planning on discussing Florence, but we can also discuss Poston Butte while I'm there.
Brian, on the pool extension or for additional service for the SEALs and for the school, would not that extend the season that we have planned right now?
The council member, the school season runs through the end of October. So yes, it might extend it a little bit, but if we're only extending it for them and not doing anything else, I think we should be okay, because that would just be a couple hours in the afternoon that they would need the pool there.
Okay, so you would not be continually opening that all day long. It would just be for the amount of time that they're going to use it.
Correct, and if it's the SEALs, it'd be their fee would be in the rental or whatever agreement we work out would cover the cost that they're there, and then the additional time for the school would be within the IGA, whatever agreement we end up having with them.
In your aquatics program, have you expanded it to take a look at some of the projects, or are the SEALs going to bring their projects over they were doing, or are we taking a look at doing some of that ourselves? What?
Mayor, again, we are very preliminary discussions, but they've got some great ideas as far as programming that I think we could do without impacting our budget significantly. Whether that's aqua aerobics or things that maybe we're currently doing, but they could do through kind of a rental agreement with us. I think that we've got a lot of options there, but we haven't finalized anything.
Okay.
Will we have to heat the pool during that time?
Mayor, Councilmember Anderson, I would imagine we'd probably have to heat it towards maybe the end of September and the month of October, and that would be it. Again, if there's any additional costs with heating associated with the SEALs or any other user group, hopefully we'd be able to pass that along to those users.
Okay, thank you.
And you anticipate, have you come up with a structure fee of what we're going to be charging yet? Or are you still working on it?
Actually, we have a draft of the fee schedule, and that's going to be made available to the Parks and Recreation Advisory Commission and then to you guys as soon as we can.
Good.
We're the goal would be to keep the fees affordable this year and then see how things are shaking out, and if we have to make any adjustments for next summer, we would do it at that time.
Good. Go ahead, Tara.
And with your fee schedule that you're creating, are you going to also be monitoring where the usage is coming from, whether it's in-town residents, residents that are north of in-town, residents that are out of town?
Mayor, Vice Mayor, Walter, yes. It'll be a little more difficult with the open swim, and that's the challenge that every city has, because you can't stop a 10-year-old or a 12-year-old who might be coming in with their fee and say, are you from here? So typically there's no non-resident rates, but anything we do as far as passes, swim lessons, things like that where pre-registration is required, we'll be able to monitor that pretty closely. Open swim might be a little bit more informal tracking.
Okay. It would just be good information, especially for us to be able to enter into a database looking at the future.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I already brought that up about the grand opening on the 4th. If we are able to have the grand opening.
We will.
We're going to, right, Brian?
Yes, sir.
And to find out residents, non-residents, but where they're from. And I think we can fill out a sheet and it would go pretty fast where they can just, somebody can sit there and mark it down. Huh?
Just for future reference, can we create some kind of system like we do with library cards so that you can tell residents and non-residents, even as far as the fee structure goes, that might be helpful if you can have a similar plan to the library card.
Again, with passes, if anybody buys a pass, it's much easier to track it that way. Again, it's your drop-in swim that might be a little bit more difficult.
Or even tie it to the library card. It's Pinal County. Possible.
I mean,
information's already there. It's just a swipe. They already have the software at the library.
I guess I need to ask the council, do you all have any pet projects you want to see get completed this next year when we have the money available, if we do have extra money available? Or do you want to take it and put it into the rainy day fund? Or, I mean, what's your guys' feeling on it?
In my opinion, I think we just need to do the basics, because I'm a little uncomfortable with us tapping into our rainy day fund for things that are not absolutely necessary. I know this was an unusual year, had a lot of big projects, but I think we need to buckle down on spending and not just spend, because we know that we can tap into that fund. We need to be frugal funds and not do things that are not absolutely necessary. Maybe we have to put off some projects, which we have done in the past, but I think we need to really put a cap on spending wildly.
Bill?
Yeah, I feel that until we know what projects we've already passed and are in the midst of almost getting completed, until we know what those are actually going to cost year to year, I think we need to, pull in our reins and just do what is required on day-to-day business. I don't think we need to jump into any more projects right now. Also, recognizing that the state legislature just can't seem to get their act together, they could even affect us even more in the future on cutting back. They're doing some bizarre stuff with the school system and the cities and towns, and it's amazing, but until they get their act together, I think we definitely need to be very conservative, and I think we need to, cut anywhere we can, and just like anybody would. I mean, any private person, you can't spend more than you're taking in. Your savings account will run out, and we know things are going to get more expensive anyway, so we need to really buckle down and take care of the stuff that we really need.
Becky, I think I know your answer.
Well, I'm very conservative. The way I feel about it is that we should not be implementing any projects until you get your capital improvement plan situated and figure out what next capital improvement projects are going to be. And then I don't know what you're considering a rainy day fund, but right now we basically don't have any, because you're spending your monies over what you basically are generating. So until we, and that's another thing we discussed about coming up with mid-year projects that are not budgeted. That should not be happening. You have to have a plan, unless it's a dire emergency, like something fails that we weren't planning on, that's when you have to utilize your monies. But considering a project that wasn't budgeted for, I am not in favor of.
John?
I agree. We talked about this during the budget meeting. If we have a well failure, for example, and it costs us $1 million, you know, we're going to have to float bonds to get that money. And so, no, we can't afford any pet projects right now.
Well, new member of the council, I know you haven't had a lot of time, but you've got your own ideas, I think, and I'd like to hear them.
Well, as far as pet projects are concerned, I don't at this point. One of the things that I was able to do and with the budget as it's presented was some percentage increases and decreases. And the one that captured my eye the most is what Becky was referring to. The projected fund balance at the end of the 2014-15 fiscal year versus the requested fund balance at the end of the next budget year is a decrease of over 18%. And if we continue that 18% spending rate year over year, it won't be very long before we don't have any reserves or ending fund balances. And I am definitely a fiscal conservative, and until I have a chance to really dig into some of the detail, which unfortunately there wasn't a lot of in the budget document that I received, I would not venture to guess on any pet projects.
Dirk?
I do. I actually, I want to talk about a few things just before we get into just some projects along with the whole budget overview. When we're looking at the budget overview in 2012, for example, there was some issues with that whole salary schedule that we moved to that were never properly addressed. And I understand that at this time it would cost way too much money to properly address those issues. However, I'm also aware of the situation at where the manager oversees personnel. Some people have received increases in their salary upwards of $30,000 over the past 2 years. That needs to stop because it impacts our budget. We need to look at it as a whole and say, okay, where are people falling and how are we going to progress them accordingly? We also have some departments within our organization that have part-timers that are paid as well as full-timers. And these people also have the opportunity to work elsewhere. So it's there's some discrepancies within our system that we really do need to address. Right now, our funding doesn't allow us to address those issues at that time, but we do need to stop with, you know, especially the raises without taking into consideration. One of the reasons I bring that up as well is because the organization-wide, it shows that a 3% average merit-based stipend. Now, I understand that when you're given the stipend, it's all in one lump sum, which there's two issues with that. It's my understanding that that stipend is sort of like that 3% increase that they would get, or 2%, whatever correlates with their merit score increase. If that employee chooses to move on to another field or another employer, we've just given them that whole bulk sum right then and there. Now, the second point that I want to bring out with that is retention. Some people, you know, like, it's a perk as you, well, it's not a perk, it's just as you're working in your career, you're working towards your retirement. So every year when you receive a salary increase or, you know, you move on that scale, that's why I know in the school district, we lose a lot of teachers that we've put a lot of time and training in, and they move on because they, you know, they were frozen for so long. So I think that that's not really going to be an increase or a decrease either way if we do that. So I think that's something that we might not want to do. If anything, it could cost us in the retention issues. I have a few more things when I was going down through the list. I was hoping you can clarify With the grants coordinator position frozen, I had an idea where we can work to train our department heads and assist them. I know our librarian was very successful in receiving over a $100,000 grant. So if we can, you know, share that knowledge and get the training out there to where we can be seeking some fundings. I know, Charles, you had shared that this is the highest amount of grants that we've had in the past year or two. So, I mean, we are doing things. We're being proactive. I just want us to continue that, especially in the other departments. Now, if you could just clarify for me where it says elimination of temporary captain assignment. I'm unaware of that.
What page?
Of the position. Oh, I'm on the budget highlight sheet. I apologize.
Page 1.
Page.
If you all may recall, Vice Mayor, Mayor, Council, you all may recall several years ago, prior to my arrival, you all had a fire chief that, because of some issues within the fire department, we really could not have him as fire chief, so there was a temporary assignment to captain. Last year, in order to alleviate some of the conflicted issues we created a temporary assignment for which I submitted a memo and let you all know that I was going to do that because I needed to avoid that conflict that was occurring because of relationships within the fire department. So I removed that individual. So at this point in time, my understanding, to the best of my knowledge, we are going to have a captain that's going to be leaving the town of Florence here in the next few weeks, month, whatever that is. And the current incumbent in that position has already been notified that he will be moving back on the engine as a captain, and that will not affect any relationship issues that we have there. But it is a budget savings, and it's something that that individual was warned about doing about a year and a half ago.
Okay, excellent. And then, with the facilities service fund, because right now it's my understanding that we have two positions in, like our facilities management position is currently occupied by two people.
Okay, what's your question? I'm sorry, Vice Mayor. We are not eliminating the position. Currently, one of the incumbents, and you all received the paperwork on Monday for the retirement, so then there will only be one individual in that position.
I didn't receive the paperwork yet, but I'm sure it's right here.
I believe it's on the agenda for the 15th.
Okay. And then I just wanted to point out, because when we talked about on one of the pages, you had a property tax increase as a possible solution. The reason why, and I understand Mayor Rankin, you're on the same page, especially when you say we do not want to see property and tax increases. We have to also understand our entire population, and you are aware that the residents in the northern area of Florence, you know, they have the community center, and we're looking at the budget saying, okay, $579,000 is going towards the community center and library, and if we took that out, really we'd only be looking to make up a difference of $370,000, but now we're looking to make up almost $1.2 million.
Vice Mayor, Council, I wasn't trying to lead you all down a road to look at a property tax increase. I just need you to know property tax is out there, and with the state hidden us, you all need to look at that at some point, how that effect's going to occur us over the years if it keeps happening. That's all it was meant to do.
Okay. And then could I have one more point of clarification? It was on the page under cemeteries, and it was budgeted for a cemetery donation of $10,000. I was just wondering, is that donation coming into us, out from us? Where is it going?
I'm not sure if Wayne could answer that question. Morris Taylor called me and said that we were going to be receiving a donation of $10,000 to improve or add lots, I believe, to the cemetery. So there's a $10,000 donation in the budget as well as a $10,000 expenditure.
Excellent. If it's possible, we'd like to know who made that donation so we could thank them.
Yes, there'll be an RCA to council on July 1st. And
where is this?
I do regret that. I forget the gentleman's name, but he is a longtime Florence resident with quite a number of relatives in the area, and he decides to trade some lots in order to get the number of lots or plots that are unison or in together at the cemetery is necessary to replat a certain portion of the plots. And so what we have, we're gaining an additional 2,700 plots, and that will afford the donor to get his 60 plots that he had previously acquired back in the year 2001. And I apologize again, I forgot the donor's name, but again, you'll see it in an RCA on July 1st.
Okay, thank you. That was all I had right now.
I got a pet project. I want a community center. We're not going to get it. Darn it. I don't have a community center. I want a recreation center where the people of the area can come for volleyball, basketball, weight training, special classes, dance, somewhere that Florence Fury can go to practice. That's what I want, but I know I can't get it right now.
No, I don't think so. I think we've gone above and beyond for the time being.
I don't. I don't think we can.
Well,
ever.
I know. You do whatever.
I'm the mayor, and I have the floor right now. I think that we still, while we're being very conservative, we have got to look to the future of Florence as we're being conservative in not stymieing growth. We've got to look forward to making ourselves more presentable to the public coming in, to businesses that may want to come here. We can't just stop, and we're going to be stopping a little bit this year. But we still have to progress. We have to put out a feeling that we're still there if we can, and we can be the community that we want it to be. The community of Florence, Arizona, runs all the way from Judd Road to Hunt Highway down to Kelvin Road. And we're all one community, and we're having to work at this. More retail sales are coming. More retail sales will be leaving us. As we all know, they open and shut up. They can't make it because the population isn't here yet. I want the best for the kids of Florence. And I think that, you know, that's just my feeling right now, but I also want good roads for our people to work on. At one time, we had the best roads in the county, and we're doing a pretty good job still of maintaining them, but we're going to have more roads to maintain, depending on the lawsuit with the mine over their property, and when we expand Hunt Highway, it's going to have to be it'll be our dime if we take that property over. It'll be the town doing that. We still need to work with the developers that are out there that are thinking about developing along the Hunt Highway corridor and remaining firm in the size of Hunt Highway out there on the road width. But I see us coming a long way this last year. Last 2 years, we've come a long way from what we were 2 years ago. We have more to offer. And while we have to cut in our spending a little bit this year, I understand that, and it's not a little bit, it's quite a bit. But we have a duty to the people who voted for us on this special election to make darn sure that we stay within that budget of what we said we're going to do.
That's right.
That's why I said, you know, I'm not going to get my rec center this year, I know that. But in 2 or 3 years, hopefully the economy has come back, the housing industry will come back, and we'll be able to get into that soon. But folks, we got to stay within this budget. And I think Becky and John, are you, since you were on the committee, are you satisfied where we're at on this budget, ready to go forward with?
Well, I think we're going to have to go forward with what we've got right now, but given saying that, there is to be monitoring of this budget. You cannot spend everything that's been budgeted for, and I'm talking about the general fund. That has got to be cut back because you can't continue like this.
Okay.
And can I be recognized? Yes. Actually, you know, we're a town of, 9,000 people now, not counting the prisoners. But we're running a budget like we're including the prisoners out here. You know, we've got more revenue than any other town of our size, yet here we are gonna spend more money than we've got coming in. So all I'm saying, we have to live realistically. You know, I'm all for the town growing, believe me. you know, all I'm saying is we need to start acting like we're a town of 9,000 people instead of acting like we're a town of 25,000 people. And, you know, yeah, it'd be great to have all these projects. We don't even know what we built, what it's going to cost us right now. That could affect us big time come the next budget. It's an experiment right now. So, you know, yeah, you know, I don't want to, I'm not against moving forward or having any new projects, but until we get things under control, I think we need to take a breath.
Mayor?
Mr. Mayor?
I would like to make a comment on this. I share your vision of the recreation center also, but as everyone says, we have to postpone this for some years, mm-hmm. and you are not going to be able to pay cash for this like you did with this. You should have done some bonding on this last one because you depleted quite a bit of your capital funds when you did this. You have to plan for the future. You can't say, okay, I've got all this money, let's spend it. We're going to have to do some bonding, and that doesn't mean your taxes are going to be raised. We're going to pay for it with money that we're already bringing in. Those are called revenue bonds. That you pay for them either with certificates of participation, or you make monthly payment or biannual payments on those. But you cannot pay cash for this next project, or you'll be depleting all of your money.
Right. Yeah. Well aware of that.
I think the key word, Mr. Mayor, I agree with you. We want to continue to grow. We want our town to grow. We want our town to be a success. But I think the key to it is planning. We need to sit down and challenge all of our department heads, all of our employees, on how to control cost, how to be more efficient. We need to work smarter. We need to work harder. We need to get cost under control so that we can move forward. And there's going to be a lot of challenges in the future that we want to be able to accept, take on those challenges. But we've got to get this expenditure thing under control.
I think that we've spent within our means and maybe gone just a little bit over, I think, but it's been growing each year.
Yeah.
The revenues haven't been coming in as what we'd like, but I think our department heads have really done a good job with what we've given them to do with, what we've asked them to get accomplished. I think our department heads have really tried to work within their budgets, except the anticipated changes that we've made as a council coming down the road. I want to thank all the department heads for working on this year's budget and making the cuts and bleeding, because I know how that is. Don't go out just because we're here at the end of the fiscal year and spend all your money, because you get shut down in a hurry. John's watching that. Becky's watching it. They're watching it. So don't do that. Budget accordingly. Work within your budget. If you have money to return at the end of the year, thank you. It won't strip you next year if we can afford to go up a little higher. That was one of the things in government I've seen, is everybody at the end of the fiscal year wants to spend all their money and come back. We've seen that. You don't have to do that. We're not going to penalize you next year. We appreciate the job you've done for the citizens of Florence. Man, I wish we had the money, but I'll get my recreation center one of these days. Some way or another, I'll get it.
I'd John? Like to ask a question on page 25.
Okay.
There's a donation expense there out of Parks and Recreation for $25,800. What's that for?
Councilmember Anderson, Mayor, Council, in many of the departments, we do have a donation expense because throughout the year, departments receive donations from various sources. And we have a tracking. We track that via a spreadsheet that shows the amount of donations that we've received versus how much we've spent. That balance in this particular line item that you see, $25,800, is an accumulation of donations that have been received but not yet spent.
Thank you.
Any other questions of the department heads? or Mike and Lisa or Becky and John and Charles.
Mr. Mayor, Council, I have a few things I need to get direction on.
Okay.
The first one, if we can go back to this slide, I need to see if, maybe if I get it back, if Council is comfortable allowing staff to add back in $40,000 to the fire department for part-time salaries.
Well, let me ask a question on that. We've got a fire chief here. Tell us why you need that.
Mayor Rankin, members of the council, my direction was to reduce overtime and not service delivery. And the challenge at Station 2 is really comes about because of the OSHA 1710 requirement, which is referred to as the two-in, two-out. And what that means essentially is if you send people into a dangerous atmosphere, if you send two in, you have to have two out. Well, because of the proximity of the engine, the mileage between the stations, when we have three people on the truck, the net effect of that is if they have a structure fire in the Anthem area, they have to wait for another engine to arrive before they can make entry. That's 12 minutes at least, and that's if the engine's available. So as a way to try to deal with that, we have qualified people that can bump up. So when a captain goes on vacation, we have an engineer that can bump up into that position. So what we want to try to do, and the reason I ask for that money to be restored, is as much as possible, we want to bump up people into acting positions and then backfill with part-time, which allows us to maintain our staffing level, but it does help with the overtime. Now, it's not going to 100% eliminate it, but if we want to maintain four people on the vehicle, that is one way of doing it and reducing overtime at the same time, not impacting service delivery.
Mayor, if I may, let me help Mr. Strayer out as well, Chief Strayer. The SAFER grant we got is primarily due to 1710.
Charles, you're going to have to speak into that.
The SAFER grant that we got is because of 1710. It's to add that fourth person on that engine. So if this last month or so, we've been having periods of time where there's only three people on that engine. We really need to be careful and staff that thing with four as much as possible. Otherwise, when we reapply for this grant in October, we have a slimmer chance of extending that grant. So we got to be very careful.
Under the grant you have with them, when's that grant up? Are we starting our second year or?
March 2016 is when it expires.
So this will be actually going into our second year then, would it? No, we're our third year.
We're in our second year.
We're in our second year, and March of 16 is when it's up.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, we have to take on those firefighters on a full-time basis under the general fund, right?
At this point in time, there's an additional $40,000 just for that SAFER grant to continue. If it is not continued or extended, to continue those firefighters, those three individuals, till June 30 next year.
Okay.
Can any of those changes be accommodated with schedule changes?
Are you talking about vacation leave and things like that?
No, I mean the overall schedule change.
Yeah, we're actually working on a new staffing policy as we speak, which includes leave requests and how all that is managed. And those policies are actually being reviewed right now and new ones developed to address, to minimize, for instance, how many people can be off at any given time and things like that to help manage the overtime. Yes.
And how many days they work and then how many days they're off?
Yes.
Also being considered?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Is this both fire and EMS?
Yes. Well, we provide, yes, both fire and EMS.
How many fires have you had in the last year?
I can run those stats. I can't give you off the top of my head. I couldn't answer that specifically without running those reports.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be happy to get back to you on that.
The fourth man in is only for fire, correct?
Right.
That's correct. That applies for it's IDLH atmosphere, as they refer to it, immediately dangerous to life and health. That's what the statute refers to, and that's fires or hazmat.
Have you looked at, because I know right now they're on like a 212-hour rotation, and from what I understand with that, like if they take a day within that, then basically overtime isn't calculated that way. Is there a way to almost restructure it that it would be more likely that they wouldn't take time off? Because in talking to people along the way, I've heard that that's one of the struggles in the department. And if they would look at remodifying that or restructuring that, then it would actually be more advantageous from your perspective.
The Fair Labor Standards Act really applies to the 212-hour 28-day work cycle you're talking about. And I'm not sure how much latitude there is in that. I'd be happy to defer to the Human Resources Admin section on what our options on there. We're happy to look at all options.
Because I know we're sort of unique when you look at other departments around the valley in terms of that 212 and the way that it's structured within, like if you take a day off, whether it's personal, sick, vacation, however it's structured, and how it impacts the overtime.
We're all on that cycle. There's different ways of applying it. There's latitude in how it's applied.
Right, but maybe just if you could just talk with Scott.
Sure.
And then see if you come up with anything.
Vice Mayor Walter, Mayor and Council, the Town of Florence several years ago went to the current work schedule that they're in. The town and most departments select a 28-day work period to determine the number of hours that can be worked prior to overtime calculation. In our organization, non-productive work hours, that is vacation, sick, slimmer kinds of times, those hours are deducted prior to the overtime calculation. So going to some other work schedule may or may not impact the ultimate cost, may or may not impact overtime requirements, whether we go to what's called a modified Kelly, or certainly I don't think going to 8s, 10s, or 12s would favorably impact that. I think it would probably negatively impact that. So certainly I'd be glad to work with Chief Strayer and others to look at the work schedule. But ultimately, I think you were asking whether or not another work schedule would impact the number of
No, I think we had a miscommunication.
Could be.
Not what I was going towards at all.
Okay.
Because I also know that several of our employees also have secondary employment just because of our rate is so low compared to other municipalities around us. That's part of the reason why we lose some of our employees. Like I know there's some that have been looking and
I wouldn't necessarily agree with that statement. Certainly we do have, many of our employees have secondary employment. And certainly our current work schedule facilitates that. If you're working 48 on, 96 off, it certainly gives them the flexibility to do that. But I would represent that based on our last look that I think we are competitive in terms of our compensation and benefits, but I'd be glad to look at that. Again, at this particular point in time, we did not look carefully at competitiveness this year as we did last year, simply because of our circumstances were such that it didn't make any sense to devote the time to do that.
Okay, understandable.
Okay.
Answer your question.
Could I, on that subject, once again, you know, we're trying to run our fire department like we're a town of 25,000 people, and most towns of 8,900 people, their department is either volunteer or half volunteer. You know, we could always look at that, you know, as maybe having part of the department volunteer. And one thing I think we could save money on is instead of using the fire trucks for EMT calls or EMS or whatever you want to call it, I think we ought to be using a pickup or use that ambulance that we've had, a brand new ambulance sitting here for, what, 6 years, never been used for anything other than storage. And, you know, we're putting a lot of miles on those fire trucks. You've got, if you want four guys on there, you've got four guys going to an EMT call that probably just requires two, because we have an ambulance service here that responds right away. And I keep hearing that, well, the reason we don't do that is because there might be a fire and the trucks need to, you know, we'll have to respond and everybody's already right there. Well, they're not going to leave that patient there. So obviously it'll be a different fire truck that would be the first ones to respond. But, you know, I think the fire department's doing very well right now, so.
And to piggyback, Bill, you have a great idea, especially Gila River had granted us that ambulance. And if we would go and seek out the CON, a certificate of necessity, that could be a huge, huge financial positive impact for our community and a service that we would be able to provide for the residents. One of the issues that comes up a lot of times is, because you referenced like we're a town of 9,000, I know when I first moved here back in 2007, we didn't have the fire department up in the Anthem area of Florence. Right. And as a result, we were identified for our insurance as a level 9, which means we, and with the bridge here going between the two areas of community, we paid the highest, it was like being out in county, the highest possible insurance on our house. Once that other fire department was put in and we didn't have the bridge as a barrier, our insurance went down drastically. So if we were to do away with those services for our residents, I don't know, personally, I would move.
I'm not saying do away with anything. I don't know where you heard. I don't want to get into an argument here. I said, why are we using fire trucks for EMT calls? You know, they're for fighting fires. They're not.
But what would it take for us to get the CON? Have we looked into that? Are we pursuing that right now?
The thing that we're looking at is we're looking at a department issue that needs to be brought back to us. We have this, the chief's hearing us talk. The certificate of need, that is pretty expensive. We got that. As far as cutting back on two firefighters and going to EMS calls, I'm all against that. And the reason I'm against it, Bill, is because I know what they did for me, and I know how many it took them to keep me alive. And I have all the respect for those firefighters on that, because even with the ambulance company coming to the scene, the fire department had me hooked up and doing IVs and the whole shot on me when I had that heart attack. Huh. And I would strongly, as long as we're, and the size we are, keep those four on that truck. Now, the other thing you're referring to, Bill, is a lot of our EMT calls here in town are at the prisons. I would say the majority of the EMT calls that we handle today are at one of the institutions. It's not the citizens. It's the people behind bars that are getting the majority of the services on the EMTs. Charles?
Mayor, if I may, I'm going to confirm a few things. We do have a TRV, a transitional vehicle, running out of Station 1 down here. The majority of this station here, and Chief Steer, correct me if I'm wrong, it's about 3-1 and 4-1 sometimes between here and Anthem. These people run much more phone, much more calls, and the problem out here is we have that TRV because the weight limit on some of those bridges is 6 tons, and you can't take that fire engine across that bridge. They got to go the long way. So in order to have that those EMT calls, we have to use that TRV in order to get there in time to the prison. So we are running it out of here. I think every now and then, based upon what's going on in Anthem, I know we did it a few times to try it out, but I don't think it's going on in Anthem right now. We're only doing it down here. Oh, and sorry, Ms. Vice Mayor, Walter, I want to answer the CON thing. We looked at this probably about 5-6 months ago, because I know a number of the other communities are now trying to crack into that because issues are going on with Southwest, and also AMR is trying to come in. The major problem we have, since we're under expenditure limitation, we can't do it because it adds to our bottom line. And we would probably have to bring on an additional 3 or 4 trucks, and that would add probably about another 12 to 16 firefighters. And because of expenditure limitation, we wouldn't be able to do that.
And don't we have, you know, I agree that You know, we looked at that a long time, and before this last, we've looked at that long, many times, Beck. The whole thing about it is, when you have a local hospital, it is advantageous to be able to do that for your citizens. A local hospital will take insurance. And right now, we're in a kind of a problem on that. When you've got those firefighters running those ambulances, you just can't go with one unit because you say, okay, we're taking over the ambulance service here in town. You send that ambulance to Mountain Vista, and you don't have another one here, and you have somebody else have a heart attack and die because we can't get to them, then we're in trouble because we can't transport them. Then we have a liability on our hands.
I wasn't saying we run an ambulance service. I'm just saying we're not transporting anybody now. I'm not saying transport them. All I'm saying, those million-dollar fire trucks are getting worn out doing EMT calls. I mean, it's I don't know. I think it's bizarre to myself, but maybe I'm in another world. I don't know.
So, what did everybody think about the $40,000 going to the fire department? Becky, John, you were on the budget committee. What do you guys got to say about that?
Well, I guess I wouldn't have a problem with that. You know,
it's Beck? I think that I'm looking at, Becky, is
all right.
If we cut down on the overtime.
You're adding back in $40,000 into the budget that isn't there right now. You added in the grant amount already, correct? Yes. Now you're asking for additional part-time salaries. That's only if you need them.
Yes.
Or is that going to be needed? Is that what you're asking for, a fourth position? I guess I'm kind of confused of why you're asking for $40,000 in part-time salaries when you already have the fourth person added on.
Well, we're rewriting our staffing policy, and the plan is to bump qualified people up more and backfill with part-time when we can. That's the difference.
Okay, so you're basically telling us that you're cutting down overtime.
That is what we're attempting to do by adding into this, adding
into
the part-time.
How much overtime are you actually going to be attempting to cut out?
Well, that's a very difficult question to answer because there's a lot of dynamics that go into at what point can we do it. It depends on, are there qualified people on duty to bump up on that particular day? And the circumstances of being able to do that, but I think we can use most of that money towards the elimination of overtime. So if you did an hour-to-hour calculation, it would be the $13.50 average, which is what the part-timers make, which is over $30 or so for a full-timer. So it's a 3-to-1 almost savings for every hour that we do that.
Okay. Then I would say if you are going to be saving 3-to-1 on overtime, yes. But I want to make sure that that's going to happen.
Yeah. That is the intention. Now, if that doesn't all get spent, then it will be returned.
All right.
That would be a goal that you're trying to obtain.
Yes.
By doing that.
Yes.
The direction of the council to the manager, should we go ahead and to Mike, go ahead and put it in there at this point?
Yes.
Well, we're having another work session
next
week, so can we pick it up then and look at it both ways?
Let's put it in now so that when we have it next week, we see what it does to us.
Okay, but that's in addition, the extra $40,000 is in addition to the $160,000 that's already in there? I want to make sure I'm looking at the budget right because it wasn't ready for me to look at until this evening.
That's correct. That's
Mike, so it would be $200,000 allotted to part-time employees.
It's restoring it back to where it was. Yes.
Okay.
I would need to look at it a little bit more. Like I said, I haven't had a chance to fully give it
you put that back in, and we'll put it in, and we'll see what it looks like next time.
Yes, we'll do that.
So are you going to be reducing then the overtime? Are you going to reduce it in the budget? That's what I want to know.
Anticipated overtime expenditure?
Yeah, he said he's going to 3-to-1 reduce the overtime. I want it reduced in the budget then.
Mm-hmm. I agree with that too.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Well, what is the fire department budget? What page?
It's on 23, if I'm not mistaken.
Page 22 is fire station number 1. Page 23 is fire station number 2.
You're talking about fire station 2, correct?
Yes.
Okay. You know what? I want you to look at your actual for 13-14 is $92,890 in overtime. You had $82,000, almost $82,500 in part-time. You had $108,000 in overtime. How are you going to reduce it 3-to-1? You're only projecting $90,000 in overtime this year.
The overtime budget is going to be very, very tight with the cuts. The $120,000 of that is FSLA. It's done. There's not anything we can do with that. So the remaining $80,000 is barely enough to cover sick leave and vacation. So. Okay. The overtime budget is extremely tight. This is an effort to try to mitigate that as much as we can. I'm going to do my best to do that based on qualified move-ups and the funding available to offset those costs.
I'm just asking you. You said it was going to be reduced 3-to-1. Where is the three at?
The 3-to-1 is hour for hour. If you're paying $13.50 for a part-timer versus $35.
No,
or overtime.
That's not what I'm asking. Where in the budget is it 3 right now? Is it in the budget 3 right now, Mike?
I didn't follow that.
Okay, he said he's reducing his overtime 3-to-1 by utilizing $40,000 in part-time. I can't find the 3. You see what I'm saying?
Right, I don't really have that in the budget right now. Right now the budget is set up as to the overtime with the part-time set at the $40,000 less. So, you know, I too have the same question. If we're adding $40,000 back in part-time, where would we reduce the overtime?
Ms. Galeen, Mayor, Council, if I may. Chief Stray, are you saying that with that $40,000 in part-time salaries that you won't hit up the additional overtime that's not in the budget?
What I'm trying to hit is the target I was giving on the reduced overtime. And I'm trying to make up for that cut by supplementing with part-time and moving up and covering as much as possible to hit the projected amount, because it's been substantially reduced.
Okay, so basically you're asking for $40,000 additional. You have no place to cut.
So if I'm hearing correctly, the overtime has already been cut.
Right.
In addition to the part-time salaries. So, Mr. Strayer, is that correct that the $40,000 would be in addition with no reduction in overtime?
Yes, that's right.
Why is the part-time salaries at Station 1 2013-2014, the actual was $19,393. And then for the 2014-2015 budget, goes to $202,000. And then over at Station 2, part-time 2013-2014 was $82,000. And then the budgeted down to projected to $16,000. For 2014 and 2015, I don't understand how that can happen.
He wasn't the chief, so it's kind of hard for him to answer that. I think I would have to go back over to the manager and Mike.
I mean, it's pretty weird. I mean, how it could have changed $200,000
I would suggest
one year. on the Station 1, I'm talking about part-time salaries, and then Station 2, it goes down to 16,000 for 2015.
Councilmember Hawkins, the projected numbers are based on what I did is I took a look at all the salary line items, looked at how much we've spent to date, which is I think there was about 3 payrolls left. So I tried to extrapolate the remainder based on what we've spent each, you know, in the prior months to kind of get to a projected number. So those numbers you see in the third column, those are the projected numbers based on the history. So what you're seeing in fire station number 1 is a projected number of 157,000 versus what was budgeted of 212,000. And in fire station number 2, it's looking like it's going to end up around 16,000.
That's not his issue. His issue is 13-14 actuals. Check it out. Salaries?
Yes. Let me, if I may, please. I have the answer for you. Ms. Galeen, Mr. Hawkins, Council Mayor.
Get close to your microphone, please.
The reason why that is such that like that is because towards the end of 13-14, beginning with 14-15, the TRV was put up in station number 1 with part-time personnel to alleviate the use of that engine and not being able to go over those bridges. That's when the TRV was put into place with part-time staff. That is your increase from the 13-14 to the 14-15 budget, that TRV.
I still don't understand it.
That's only that was a part-time deal out there. So what I'm looking at is what Becky was looking at on part-time salaries. Becky, give me if I'm correct me. You're looking at that part-time salaries increasing to 200,000 with the inclusion of the 40,000 they've asked for. Is that right? On page 22?
I'm looking, they're asking on page 23 is where they're looking.
Well, I was looking at station number 1.
Well, I looked at both of them, station 1 and station 2. I mean.
Well, no, but I was trying to figure out where Becky had said something about 200,000. That's where I was trying to figure it out.
Station number 1, part-time salaries. From 2013, 2014 to 2014, 2015, it went up 200,000. See on the second line?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And they said it, Charles said it's because they put the TRV on.
What's the TRV?
That's that ambulance thing, I think.
It is a transitional vehicle that we utilize because all the multiple calls at the prison, because the main engine cannot go over those bridges, and there's a 4-to-1 call level between station 2 and station 1, 3-to-4. And it started in that year. We brought it to council for approval, and council did approve that.
Well, I don't understand why it would have. Did we have to hire more employees or something?
Yes, sir. Those are part-time employees. They're not full-time firefighters. They're part-time and staffed.
Why not use the EMTs we already have full-time to do that?
Councilmember Hawkins, we don't have enough employees to do that. We would be using overtime. We would not be able to use our current employees to staff that vehicle.
Overtime. To keep both the ambulance.
If they're at the station, they're on the clock. In other words, we're going to pay the guys to sit there $35 an hour to sit there, and then we're going to pay somebody else $13.50 to run out and do an EMT call while the other full-time EMTs are sitting in the station?
Councilmember Hawkins, Mayors, the majority of this station, those two vehicles are out at any given time together, both the engine and the TRV. So if you only use the TRV...
You're saying you send a smaller vehicle?
Yes.
And you send the engine along with it?
No. We send the smaller vehicle to the prison unless there's a fire. The engine is left here in case there's another call to make. We do not send them both to the same place.
Can I add something?
Okay. Go ahead.
Mayor and Council, the other advantage of using that vehicle is it does have some basic firefighter capability, but when you respond to the prison, you can get locked out for hours out there. Mm-hmm. And if we were to send engines out there, we would lose them a lot of the day, because once you go behind the gates, you don't have control of it anymore. So that keeps our engines available for coverage. It's actually very effective, very efficient utilization of resources.
I guess what I'm looking at is I'm The 400,000 or the 40,000, you're going to be trying to save overtime pay by utilizing that 40,000. Where you budgeted under Station 1, 135,000 overtime pay, if we can get that 40,000 in there in the part-time, you think that you'll be to cut down even on that 100,000 where it is right now? That's your projection.
Mayor and Council, I do know there will be some savings from bumping up and backfilling with part-time. It hasn't been done, so I'm a little hesitant to try to give you a number. I just know there will be a savings. There has to be.
Okay.
I would suggest that we defer this to the next work session and have the staff do a little more digging into this.
Can you do that? Come up with some facts and figures on out times and downtime that they have out there?
How many calls we make to the different sections of town also? On EMT calls and fires separate. I want to know how many to the prison, how many to Florence Gardens, how many to Anthem, how many downtown? EMT calls and fire. I want to know.
Year or last 2 years?
If it's not that difficult, yeah, 2 years would be nice, and then we'd have something to compare.
Whatever we do, we don't want to take away from what we've got, but let's see if we can be saving more money. And like I said, you don't want to be in a position that you don't have a firefighter there with an EMT capability or paramedic capability to take care of you if you need it. Okay, we've been at this for 2 hours now. Let's go ahead and take a 5-minute break. Before we go into community development, we're going to get a few more things there to do. Okay, let's get back and go into the community development building inspector.
Mr. Eckhoff, would you care to explain that one, please?
I guess it's on you, Mark.
Mayor and Council.
You're turning the barrel, buddy.
Yes, sir. Mayor and Council, as you know, probably for the last 6 months plus, I've been operating with just one senior building inspector. And for months prior to that, it's been, ever since Carol Michael departed, it's been kind of rough keeping both of those positions occupied. We have a statutory requirement, both locally and from the state level, to turn around plan reviews and do inspections within a certain time. We have a large geographic area, so at the end of the day, we have a job that has to get done. But we also have a unique situation in the town of Florence where we are very customer service oriented, and we have folks call us and say, hey, can you pop over and look at this, or can you check that out, or how would you handle this, or can you help me draw this or do that? So we do have a very hands-on approach. Right now, with having one senior inspector covering all of town, all the way from the rodeo grounds up to the solar project, he's spending a good amount of time out in the field. That takes away from having somebody in the office to handle those questions. We have a lot of walk-in traffic, a lot of phone calls, folks asking us all the time, can I do this, can I do that, what code applies here? So technical questions that only a certified building inspector is qualified to address. So with that one person being out in the field, a lot of times we'll have folks come in and we don't have somebody readily available to assist them. And I don't have set hours for when an inspector can be in the office, because if he has inspections all day, he has inspections all day. They just have to get done. So right now we can't maintain the level of service that I know that we all expect, and also it has had an impact over the past year in our ability to be proactive in code compliance. When we had two inspectors, we had a pretty active code compliance effort. A lot of you recall that. And we cleaned up a lot of properties within the community, removed a lot of dilapidated structures. We had a very successful program. That can only be done at least if we have two folks on staff. And what we've always done is our greatest priority is to get the plan reviews and the inspections done. Whenever we've had any lulls in that, we've always been able to have plenty of code compliance activities to pursue. So right now we really can't be proactive in that. So we have addressed a possibility here for you to consider that we believe could end up being a wash, and that is that with engineering moving into our department, we've come up with the idea of sharing a position, and then also in our professional services budget, where we have a professional service contract with Wildan, and when we can't keep up with inspections, we refer to them to get those done. Or if we have a set of plans come in and we can't meet the deadline to get those done, the Wildan will assist. But between taking money out of the professional service line item and between engineering and community development sharing a position, I believe that would equate to the building inspector position. But this is the first time in in about 9 years that we've ever operated just with a single building inspector. And again, geographically, it's just a lot to cover, and that's of course not even reflecting what happens with the annexations. That presents a whole another bag of issues to discuss at a later date.
How many cases have we had this year for building inspector? On how many new units do we have constructed this year or permitted?
Well, Mayor, members of the council, as far as new home construction, we're doing about 20 homes a month right now. So it is picking up from the 11, 12, 13 that we're doing during the slow periods. It's not quite to the 400 a year that we were doing during some of our best years, but it looks like we could hit about 200 and 250 homes. The inspectors, though, are also we've been crazy busy with smaller projects on homes, such as the solar additions. The solar add-ons, especially in the Anthem area, have really been taken off. So you have to think also we do a gas line inspection, a pool inspection, an addition, an Arizona room. When the winter visitors are in town, there's always a lot of activity out in Caliente, Florence Gardens, etc. And you can see from our revenue line items that our permit revenues and our plan review revenues were going up again this year. They're pretty substantial, much higher than we projected, and that is a reflection in the amount of projects that we've had. We do have we have had a lot of activity in the downtown area. Our inspector has been busy on the project across the street from us, and also we've been doing a lot of tenant improvements on some of the older structures downtown, and conversions from changes of occupancy on some of the structures downtown, which are very time consuming.
Do you think that this will keep you from having to use Wildan?
We would like to only utilize Wildan in a case where it's absolutely essential, and that's obviously that's not saying anything against them, but there is never, you can never provide service with outside contractors as well as you can provide with your own staff. The efficiency, the relationships that are built, the trust that is established, when they go out to an area and they have a familiarity with the scenery and with the customers that they deal with, there's nothing that beats that. And we'll have a savings again in this year in 217 for professional services, because as it was alluded to before, we've had the money, but we've been desperately trying to not spend the money that we have, and to make sure we come up with a savings in that area. So where we have to use them, we have used them, and we would have to continue to use them in the future, because again, there's a regulatory requirement that we turn these reviews and inspections around. We're also looking at other creative scenarios on, we have a solar project that's coming up, and we looked at a creative scenario where we can get help with Wildan, but on a different kind of relationship, a third party contract basis, where we can kind of distribute the cost a little bit more amongst the parties. So we'll collect less revenues on that side, but also we'll have fewer expenditures. So we're being as creative as we can. It just would be good to get back to being a little bit more proactive on code compliance, whether that's something as simple as weeds or abandoned, it could be abandoned cars or dilapidated structures. The fire marshal helps out when we have structures that we believe are an obvious or apparent fire hazard, so that's helpful. But I know that definitely the service and the amount of things that we can do would be improved upon adding this position back to us.
You said it was a wash that you'd be looking at combining this with the engineering department?
What we've looked at doing is sharing the administrative assistant position that is in place now, and not hiring a new administrative position, and then also going into the professional services line item, the 217 of community development, and cutting then the remainder of that balance. So looking at what is saved by not hiring a new position, and then finding the difference in the 217 line item.
And who would the employee be under, you or the engineering division?
The administrative assistant right now, it looks like that it would be a community development employee, because they would be based in front of the building. So, which also would help with engineering being in that office, in that they have a representative that is out there available to talk to the public and to be on the front line, in essence.
Wayne, what do you got to say about this? Since you're going to be the engineer.
Yes, Mayor Rankin, Vice Mayor Walter. Basically, we would support that endeavor, provided that we do have some control over the individual, because a lot of our interface will be with the Public Works Department, specifically in the way we propose a revision to the code, and that requires a lot of issues concerning with the permitting requirements, the regulatory permitting requirements, and also the interface we have with development and CIPs that are enhanced. And more recently, what we did with the county is in all their contracts, and specifically for us, they did invoke a piggyback clause within their engineering, within their construction, and JOC contracts. And Mr. Anderson, Lou Anderson, the Public Works Director of the county, went out of his way, I think, to accommodate that. And we appreciate that. It does take a little more administrative effort on my part, but as long as we have somewhat control over the individual in order to support those facets of the engineering department, we would support that issue.
And so that'd be between the two of you to work that out, between you and Mark, on her duties, his or her duty?
Yes, and we would propose that to, of course, the town manager.
Okay. Anybody have any questions on that?
I do. Becky? What is the budget for that? What's the anticipated cost?
I'm sorry?
What is the anticipated cost of that position?
The anticipated cost was, as I recall, about, it was a grade survey, a grade salary scale of 30, so the overall cost, which was included in the budget, incidentally, the overall cost was, I would assume, about $50,000. Is that an approximate number?
What page is that on in here? Is that I'm trying to find it.
If I could add to that, though, however, the split on that cost was 10% in engineering, 25% in HERF fund, and the balance was in water and sewer, because, again, that was in to support of that. So that reallocation would need to take place.
Oh, I see. What I'm trying to get at is, what is your overall budget for the building inspector position, taking the administrative assistant and the Wildan costs? What are you looking at? I know it's a wash, and I understand that. I'm just trying to get at what the total cost, including benefits, are.
I wonder if there's anybody else more qualified to talk about, because when it comes to the total cost of the position, I can't tell you exactly for sure. I can tell you.
Okay. Scott, do you have anything on that?
Mayor, Councilmember Gulen, just for clarity's sake, we actually did present the reorg plan to council, which you approved. The fact is that there was not a new administrative position. There was an administrative assistant position that was going to be transferred from Public Works over to the engineer's department. And so there, unless I missed something or I'm mistaken, there was no savings involved in the administrative assistant position because it was not a new position. We were simply going to create a new position of town engineer and create and reclassify the engineering technician assistant position to engineering technician. That was the plan presented to council.
That was the original plan presented to council, but the plan just presented to council does not move over anyone from the wastewater water. What it does is it takes the current AA position that is in the community development, and then some of the work that is being done for the engineer will be transferred to other funds. What we can do is we can bring back the exact cost with the breakdown to council at the next work session, so which we don't have those numbers.
Okay. That's fine. That's what I need. We're just looking at the total. What we want to see is the total cost of that position.
Well, if I understand, the building inspector is a frozen position right now, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
That's the 56,400,000?
Yes.
56,400, that's frozen. So.
Okay, so you're anticipating that's the cost, and that includes the benefits, correct?
Yes.
That's correct.
Yes.
Okay.
So this, we've looked at this a variety of ways, and this is one of the approaches that just kind of came up recently, and it took a lot of coordination amongst folks. But we'll, as Lisa indicated, we'll bring the exact numbers to you. But the plan was to figure out how to do it in a manner that would be cost neutral.
So
and if we can't make that work, then I would like to come back with another alternative, because certainly. What we're trying to do is not add to the budget, but just maintain the level of service that the community has learned to enjoy over the years.
Well, if I understand it right, you want to restore the frozen position, and you're going to partially pay for that with this administrative assistant combination.
Yes, Councilmember Anderson, Mayor of Council, I want to restore that position, pay for it with whatever we determine to be the cost savings of not hiring another administrative assistant and sharing the one that we have in place today amongst the departments, which we would figure out the details of doing that. The remainder of the cost of that position that's frozen right now, we would look at then deducting from professional services, which we have money allocated in that account to pay for contract inspection services.
Okay, so you're not asking for a budget increase, you're just asking for
absolutely. I'm not asking for any more money. That's the way that I would like to pursue it, is that we not spend any more money.
Mark, does this require the full-time building inspector? Or have you considered a 32-hour?
Both of those positions have been full-time, Councilmember Gulen, Mayor and Council. If it were to come to it in the budget that we needed to look at another scenario, we certainly would be open to that. I believe without them being both full-time, that we won't be able to do everything that we want to do. But I know that, again, I know there sometimes it's impossible right now when you you know, when you don't have all the money that you need, that you can't necessarily do everything that you want. So we could look at all scenarios. I'd like to, again, to be able to present it in a way that's neutral, and I will be able to use two full-time employees. Again, if we go through spells in the summer where activity may slow down, what we've always found historically is that there is code compliance to do, there is plan reviews to do, there are code adoptions, there are code issues to address, there are it's just the level of keeping the level of service up to where it has been historically would require the two.
Can you provide us, when you do this research, can you tell us how many inspections that you do annually?
Absolutely. We can. In fact, in our report, already you get a monthly accounting of all the permits that are issued on a monthly basis.
But
we'd be happy to also provide you with what that equates to as far as inspections.
Yeah, well, I know on those permits, like on a new house, that's just not one inspection though, right?
Multiple inspections, and sometimes on one house it could be multiple inspections in a day, conceivably, depending on how fast they progress.
Yeah.
Well, I know we got a lot of complaints over not being able to work with the building inspector or not being able to get them. And that's why we went to Wildan back during the big boom. But I think that the position, if it can be justified, I don't have any problem with going back into the, unfreezing that position. And, does anybody have any problem?
I don't have a problem with that.
Okay. So you put that in for next week's meeting, showing that, that amount of money going into. And if you would on that one, go ahead and show the breakdown on the percentages to what funds are coming out of. It's like the manager's salary comes out of different funds. It's going to be doing the same thing with this. Or the administrative assistant position will be funded that way, where the building inspector won't. But let's take a look at the administrative position and how it's funded out of which funds. Okay.
Mayor, Council, I have two other items for you to discuss. The first one is this budget does not include what the current budget does, is the $500,000 originally set aside in case the annexations move forward. It is not in this budget whatsoever. We have not set that aside. So I know this is a discussion the council probably needs to have. I'm not sure if you are ready for it, but that is not in here. I want to make sure you're aware of that.
I think, you know, my feeling is if we went out to budget or to annex it, that if it happens, we need the money to take care of things. And we're going to almost have to include that money. If it doesn't happen and we have it budgeted, we don't have to use the money. That's the way I look at it.
Do we have the ability to budget it without impacting right now at this point, or would more cuts need to be made?
Well, Tara, it's one of those damn if you do, damn if you don't deals. What are you going to do if the annexation goes through and we can't provide the service to the people we annex? And I know we want to save money and everything, but and we don't know what the cost is going to be. What did you guesstimate, $350?
I think initially there was, on the annexation, you're talking 1 year cost? I believe a portion of the $500,000 was for police officers and additional staffing, I think, in the fire department potentially, but I think there's some capital projects in year one, but the major capital projects didn't happen in year three, four, or five. And there, it's much more.
I mean, that's one of those things that if and on the annexation lawsuit that we're in, the judge still hadn't made a ruling on it, so we don't know, and we can't really budget accordingly. So we're having to anticipate.
Is that something that could, and I think the answer is no. Is that something that could have been, you know, potentially bonded for if the annexation goes through due to our financial constraint?
You can bond for the capital projects, but if you're talking about police and fire additional staffing, you cannot bond for that.
I knew my answer was no.
Well, if we, as far as fire protection goes, how can we hire additional firemen if we don't have the equipment to?
Councilmember Anderson, Mayor, Council, one of the solutions was Mr. Hawkins' comment earlier about that spare ambulance. We would turn up the TRV full-time, most likely in the Anthem area, which would start alleviating some of that service. But if you all recall the presentation that was given to council in September 2013, there would not be a new station out there for about 4 years.
Correct me if I'm wrong. Currently with our fire department, we would be able to service the annexed areas if they were actually annexed with our current staffing, correct?
Station 2 could respond out there, yes.
Okay, because that's appropriate response time. It wouldn't.
Yeah.
It would maintain those levels.
I can't tell. I've been here for 4 weeks, and I'm not using that as an excuse, but I have not run numbers on that yet. I've been dealing with some other things, but I can run those numbers and get back to you on it. We can respond out there. It's reasonably close. I can't tell you that it meets the national standards for response times without doing some more research.
Okay.
Happy to do that.
Councilmember Walters, I believe the original presentation was basically, it depends really on call volume, first of all, and then length of call, where they're going. and we probably wouldn't know that for several months in before we added anything as far as firefighters. We just wouldn't know.
Police. We would definitely need additional resources for those areas.
Probably more than anything, I'd want to make sure that we were fully staffed in the dispatch area. What we do now is probably relocate some of the officers and utilize some different shifts to try and make the appropriate coverage.
Yeah, that's right.
But I believe we could do it. And again, it's going to be call volume. Right now, I can tell you that the call volume for the county, they seem to feel like it's pretty high. I think if we did some good crime prevention, we could bring the call volume down.
Okay.
Now, you're talking the Oasis area, correct, is what mm-hmm. you're talking about, rather than the Wild Horse?
Yes.
One of my suggestions would possibly be, since we already have that out there, we've already gone out to the annexations, my feelings on the matter is we should find a way to allot that in the budget. However, we also would want to make sure that you looked at the 40 hours and you had the overtime just in case we needed to provide services, as well as an additional fire or additional police position or two and a dispatcher to cover those areas.
And I want to clarify something I did say earlier. I recall when we had those discussions, we would wait for the call volume, but we'd also said we'd run two engines, most likely at a station two, until it warranted an additional station, whatever period of time that was.
But what if we didn't add any additional people right now? We just worked with what we had, because we need to make it with our budget.
And we could possibly do that without a doubt with fire and police. We'd have to work with the fire, with the police chief.
So, and that's where it would default back to, you know, making sure they have what they need within their budget, so that way they can make the adjustments, because otherwise they wouldn't be able to.
Or we keep it under the council, put the 350 in our budget and allocate it out of there to their budgets if it's needed. If it's not, then we send it back in then next year.
What's the 350 for?
I think that's what you said that you wanted, didn't it?
500.
The original amount was $500,000.
But we came down off that, didn't we?
I believe that was the original amount. That was not just for some police officers, and I believe it was potentially for firefighters, but it was for some life and health safety issues out there in regards to roadway and signage, some capital stuff that we needed to complete.
But for a roadway, wouldn't that be infrastructure that we could bond out for?
No, what I'm trying to grasp is I thought you just said that we would not need to increase fire and police. We would utilize what we have right now. Is that what you said?
We would keep fire because they could provide that service area, but we might need to add an additional police officer, possibly two, just to make up that area, because we have that position frozen, it's my understanding, and we're already a little bit short-staffed with our dispatchers, and they're overworked, and I asked the police chief earlier if he could get the numbers of what are we paying on overtime for the dispatchers, as opposed to what if we just added another dispatcher.
Would you need to add additional staff for that area, annexation area, chief?
My plan is to utilize the current personnel that we have to maybe, well, what I would probably do is I have the town divided into three beats. What I would probably do is combine beat one and beat two, because their call volume could be handled. And then because of the distance, the Anthem area is what I call beat three, and then we would make beat four. And when staffing, when we can, I'll staff all four. When we can't, I'll staff one and two with one person, three with an officer, and four. Now, as far as dispatching goes, the problem there has been, we have been down on dispatchers, so we've been going through a lot of overtime. And it's not that we're not trying, and it's not that we don't have great people, it's just simply that it's a tough job, and it's a tough job to fill. So sometimes we're down two and three dispatchers. Someone will get married and move to Marin City, like just happened, or another dispatcher decides, you know, I really have got the opportunity, I'm gonna stay home with my children. So it's just a tough job to keep filled, and you work nights and weekends, so. That's my biggest concern.
So what you're saying actually is you could work with your existing staff without adding additional staff?
I'll do my best to do that, yes.
The Mayor and Council, what I was thinking, and you know what I could suggest for the next work session is to bring back a budget that would, for purposes of putting into this document or in the adopted budget for the annexation, is to bring back numbers that are that came from our fiscal study that was done for the annexation, and just kind of show you what that study has. I think that's the best information that we have at this time, is what that study came up with. And what I will do is put together a spreadsheet that will look like another department or departments, if you will, in each fund that would be affected, and then we could maybe see what that looks like, and you know, on paper.
Can you also tell us what the income is going to be?
That's correct. I'll put that all together as it is stated in the impact study.
Okay.
And I'm going to doing that, split it up into each annexation.
Correct. The Magic Farms and the Arizona.
Or Arizona Farms and Magic Ranch.
Magic Ranch.
Split that up.
And Charles, they won't count towards our population for, is it a year or 2 years?
I'll have to defer, Councilmember Walters, to Mr. Eckhoff, because there is always an opportunity that we can do an interim census. It just depends what that timing is. So in the normal census, falls
every 10
2015.
Years.
So, yep, we're going to miss it.
We'll be accepting responsibility without any reimbursement from the state on that for at least 2020. And then it's a couple years after that for the, if you don't do a special, well, you just went through listening to this stuff about the special census. We're too late to do that. Those positions are all gone. The money the federal government put up for that, it's all gone. So these people won't be included until the next census, which would be in 2020.
Mayor and Council, there is another provision that is allowed in some communities throughout the United States where you can add the population based on the last census of that area. So it's not a new census
okay.
of that area, but it's a way of taking those census tracts that were counted in unincorporated Pinal County and transferring the number into this municipality. And then it's just a matter of how quickly the Department of Revenue, the state of Arizona, et cetera, can get those revenues adjusted. So there's a way of doing it more quickly than doing a special census or waiting to the 2020 census.
I wasn't aware of that. That's changed since I...
It's not extremely common, but actually that was the mechanism that we were prepared to utilize and had everything in place to have that population transferred on the effective date of this annexation. But obviously we had to contact the census and tell them to put that on hold.
Okay, so you'll have that available at the next work session. Okay.
Mayor,
were you going to talk about the long-range and financial planning and the capital improvement plan?
I think, Mayor, the stance that staff was recommending is we really needed to do both the long-range financial plan, and we do need to start updating the capital plan, because a lot of those capital items kept rolling over year to year. All the department heads really need to spend some time going through all these, look at them, research them, and then bring them to council for consideration and start putting them on or placing them on some sort of timeline. We haven't done that in some time, and we really need to do that one way or the other. And then as far as the utility rate study, we'll start looking at that and evaluating that and seeing what we can do and bring something back to council as far as a recommendation as to how we're going to approach that. And then the last item is Ms. Vice Mayor Walters brought up whether or not you all wanted to eliminate the 3% stipend. So I need to see where council is with that.
I would suggest that we look at eliminating the stipends selectively, maybe eliminate from the department managers, the high-end pay, and not penalize the employees.
See, and it wasn't the stipend, it was instead of, because in the past we've always done it where it was the merit increase and this was replaced with the stipend, And then I know most recently it was more of the department heads had received like the stipend, which was the full amount at one shot for the year. But instead of doing that, having it go into what we've been doing in the past, because it wouldn't be a fiscal impact from what I can see, other than it, you know, benefits the employee by, in the long range, actually going towards the retirement.
Councilmember Walters, Council, if I may, the 3% stipend was given to directors by myself rather than giving them an annual 3%, because I didn't want to expand the base anymore, knowing that we had expenditure limitation. The recommendation from staff at this time was to give all employees the 3% stipend as a one-time, because we didn't want to add to the base. It will add to the base approximately $340,000 annually if we give a regular 3% merit.
Okay.
And it was given on their anniversary date, not on like July 1. It was based upon their anniversary date.
So we're talking about $300,000 to do the stipend, 3% stipend to everyone.
And the stipend is the same as the merit increase either way. It's just how it's worded.
Councilmember Walter, Mayor, the only difference is the $339,000 is in this year's budget, and that would be a budgetary impact. However, when you're still faced with another election, that $339,000 won't compound into the next fiscal year. That's the only difference.
Okay.
Now, you brought up a...
I see what you're saying.
You brought up a point earlier, and I agree with you on giving them up front. Boom. ADO, so I'm gone. Thank you for the present as I walk out the door. Is there... John, I don't agree with you on, I think if we're going to give it to employees, we ought to give it to department heads too, if we can afford to do it, give it across the board. The only thing I would say is let's put this some sort of a, at the end of the fiscal year, rather than at the beginning, and then you can prorate it out as a, if they leave before the end. They just don't get that whole 3% of what their salary is. You see where I'm coming from?
I don't follow.
Okay.
The way that we currently do it is employees have to go through and they have to have their evaluations done. So we do it at the end of their year, and then the employees are spread out throughout the fiscal year. We can bring back a report showing you a separation of the dates, showing when people get their increases. And also I'd like to say, Vice Mayor, you brought up some good points, and what we can do is we have a great HR director, and what we can do is we can have him go back in and look at the part-time salaries, a part-time scale, and look at what we have going on to see if he has recommendations to adjust that part-time scale, because it would not be an increase, because you had concerns about employees that are on a part-time level making the same thing as employees on our full-time level. We can go ahead and look at that, and we can also come up with a plan for when we are fiscally sound and have our home rule options back, his recommendations for how the town of Florence should go through and fix the compression and fix the scale to make sure that we're not only competitive. He's done a white paper on it already. It's a beautiful piece of work, and I'd love to have him share it with you.
You still understand what I'm saying? Lisa, are you talking about at the time of their yearly evaluation given at the...
I'm talking about the time of their annual evaluation when a department brings in the employee and sits them down and talks about how well they did. That's the time when they are given their stipend. So you have to be working for one complete year from the date that you received your last evaluation. Everyone has anniversary dates that are different. So when you go through and you look at the impact when you're affecting someone's salary, that's how you say it would be a 3%. You can't take a 3% based on the whole salaries that you have, because it comes in and it's a different. Some people have theirs in June and they're only affected by 1 month. Other people have theirs in January and it's 3 months when you add it to their regular salary. In this case, they do receive a stipend at one time, but it would still be on their anniversary date. It would not be the town of Florence cutting out a $300,000 check in one day. And if they leave prior to their anniversary date, they would not receive that.
Well, that's, why do we have to go with the anniversary date? Why can't we start at the first of fiscal year? And in that way, everybody is on the same page. Everybody, to me, it seems like it makes accounting a little simpler.
It's a very unfair way to do that with the employees. We had a situation where we tried that 1 year. I believe it was on July 1, everybody got such and such, and then they put a wage freeze on. Well, guess what happened? Those people that were up front had to wait almost 2 years once we re-implemented to get a wage increase. It was very unfair. That's why you have to do it on the anniversary date, or it throws the whole structure out of whack.
But what happens now if we approve this in July, and the end of July, somebody's anniversary date comes up, and they get all their money?
Okay, stop. Let's stop and think about this, because I was sitting here trying to figure this out.
I made a mistake, and let me clarify it, because I think he's feeding off of that. When I had talked about you're paying them the stipend up front for the year, Lisa corrected me. It's the year that they already worked that they're getting paid for. So they already worked for that full year, so that's why they're getting that stipend. And then Mike clarified another point of saying we can't add it to the base. It would be a one-year thing just until we get the permanent home rule passed, which I can understand that, but this was the first time, again, that I had to look at it in depth. And
the way that we do, like if you did a cost of living adjustment, the way that you do cost of a living adjustments is typically at the beginning of a fiscal year, and everyone will receive a cost of living adjustment. Do you want to jump in at all here?
I would like to make one clarification, specifically to Vice Mayor Walter's point. Even when you give a stipend, employees are required to pay retirement contributions on that stipend, and that stipend is included in their compensation for the year, so they're not compromised in any way from a retirement benefit perspective. Whether it goes in the base or it's paid on a stipend, there's no implication to that. So it's just a different way of paying it. Instead of spreading it out over the year, you're paying it a lump sum. But they're still paying retirement on that. We're still matching that retirement or paying the town's share. And it's still included in their compensation for the year.
Correct. But what I was saying is the long-range retirement.
Compounding, you're exactly right. There's not a compounding issue. And that's the point actually being made about the stipend. It's not compounding, and there's all kinds of we've talked before about the complexity of compensation plans and what have you. So, but that point certainly from a compounding perspective, you're exactly right.
I have a question. The way this reads, it says merit-based stipend. Does that mean that there are potentially employees who would not get this 3%?
Let me clarify that, Councilmember Wall, if I may, Mayor. No, the recommendation actually should be a 3% stipend for all employees, but they still need to go through the performance process. All employees still need to go through that performance process. Once they go through it, they should receive the 3% stipend.
Councilmember Wall, if you want information about how our system works, it is merit-based. There's also a matrix in terms of a person's tenure or position in the salary range. So it does vary. I think that was your question. It could vary from 0 to 3.
See, government can make
Mayor, Council, I'm going to clarify. Scott, I'm going to clarify. The recommendation is everybody receives the 3% after they have their performance review.
Okay. And you said, on their annual review.
Correct, on their anniversary date.
Well, I just hope we can afford it. I think we can. I think our employees deserve it. But okay, so that'll be in. You're going to put that in the budget for next. Mike, you'll have that in the budget for next meeting.
I'm sorry, Mayor. What was the question?
You're going to have it in the budget for next meeting.
It's already in the budget.
The stipend.
Yeah, that's already in the budget.
It's already in there.
Yes.
Okay. You didn't tell me that, Vicki. Is that it on that? Okay, well, folks, that looks like, is any other discussion any of the council members have for staff on our budget?
Mayor Rankin, I clarify, are we having another study session on the 18th?
Sure.
Okay, just wanted to clarify, thank you.
At what time?
Is that gonna throw our budget?
Actually, not the 18th. What, July 18th?
June.
Not June 18th. Yes, June 18th. I apologize. You threw me off.
Is that going to throw our budget schedule off and advertising and all of that? Is there any problem with the property tax levy on this?
I'll have to go back and look at the calendar and see where this puts us. But I don't believe, I think we can still do the property tax at the same times as already scheduled, except for the actual adoption of the levy. But as far as the truth in taxation hearing and the first and second readings, I think...
You've already started that?
Still be fine. It's not started yet, but it is on the calendar to be started.
I would just like to point out one thing. As you all know, in the adoption of a tentative budget, it is a tentative budget. If council chose to put it on the 15th and adopt a tentative budget, you still get to go back in and cut that. You still get to have all your work sessions. You still get to have everything. That is not your final budget. Just wanted to put it out there.
You just can't exceed the tentative.
You can never exceed the tentative. So if you're planning on adding more things into the budget, you can never go backwards.
I'm just saying no, just because we had this work session for June 18th going on. This is the first time we've been able to sit down as an entire council to look at the budget. Some of us, as much as tonight, had the budget in front of them for the first time.
I know. I was just making the comment about the budget schedule with the TNT, the truth in taxation notices that are required.
Because we still have that emergency clause that we're adopting anyway when we go forward, because that's been procedural in the past years as well.
As long as we adopt a tentative budget in June, but the problem is when you look at it, Mr. Farina has to know at what point to advertise public hearings. And what we can do is we can say that our meetings that we have planned in July, where Mr. Farina is not going to be with us, that those are going to be hard dates, so that Mr. Farina, while he's here, can go ahead and advertise when the final is going to go forward. See what I'm saying?
Are we still having the special meeting on the 29th?
We will have to have the special meeting on the 29th to adopt that budget, and then we will have to go in and have, what is July 6th, Mike? Is that the date of Monday? July 6th, we'll have to do the public hearings and everything that's required. What you will be doing is we will be going forward without our finance director, because he will leave on July 3rd, if I am not mistaken. So I would like to make sure that he at least tees everything up, gets everything required that's in the paper, advertised in the paper, gets all the documents processed. I know we're asking a lot of him, but we love him. He's been great to work with, and we're appreciative that he's willing to do this for us. But just to make sure that we have a schedule to where we do not get off track, to where we have a path to follow once he's gone.
All right, then that sounds like the plan. We'll have the next meeting on the 18th, the special meeting on the 29th, with the final on the 6th.
What are the times on those meetings?
I think what I'd suggest to you is to get out a schedule of these meetings to all the council, either by email or whatever, so we can get them in our calendar. And if you get those out by tomorrow, I'd appreciate it. If that's okay with the rest of the council, then you'll have them.
They already know the time. Do you not know the time right now?
I do not know the time. I will be contacting you to ask you if you'd like to keep the 3 o'clock date or if you'd like to move it to 6. If you'd like to tell me now, I don't have to reach out and contact you. I will just set those meetings and put out the schedule.
Okay, well, let's...
3 o'clock works good for me.
Well, we've already been here 3 hours, so if we make it at 6, we make it at 9, we go to midnight. Of course, some of you are working. Who's?
Three's fine with me.
No, I was talking about Tara and Valerie.
I'm fine.
But you're off right now, aren't you?
I am not off, but I can make adjustments.
Okay. Let's go ahead and schedule the meeting at 3 o'clock.
I will do that, and I'll put out a schedule for everyone. Thank you.
Get those schedules out tomorrow at the very latest, okay? Thank you.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, John.
Just a question about public input. You know, we still have a few people that have stayed with us here tonight. When does the public get to make comments or questions on the budget?
What is this schedule? Yes.
We will have a public hearing.
We've got a public hearing.
That's required before the formal adoption. And what I'll do is when we are putting together these these dates, what Mike will do, he already has a budget calendar, so I will go ahead and update that budget calendar, and then I'll send that out to you. I'll highlight the budget hearing dates, and I'll go ahead and notice those in three places.
And that budget will be put on the website?
We will put it on the website.
Good.
Oh, you know what? I won't be available on the 18th anyway. But life goes on. I won't be available on the 18th. I'll be having surgery that day.
Just to clarify, would you like us to proceed without you being present?
Yes.
Okay.
On the... On the long-term planning, you know, we were talking about, I noticed in the dispatch yesterday, Casa Grande is $35.7 million in the hole on their retirement funds. And my understanding is from what I've, well, what I've read in the paper over the last couple of years, most of the cities and towns in Arizona are in the red on their retirement, on this state retirement fund that everybody goes into and all that. So I'm thinking, you know, somewhere along the line, we need to come up with a different system, either start 401ks with new employees or whatever. I mean, we're obligated on the present employees, but somewhere along the line, because I asked our finance people, and they we're in the red, but we're not in the red that bad, but it's something, you know, that's very serious, and we're constitutionally obliged to pay that no matter what. If we don't pay anything else, we pay that. So I'm thinking, you know, as they were suggesting in the paper also, to look at a 401k or something like that. I know it's not going to be real popular, but, you know, all the cities and towns are in trouble with that, so I'm just putting it out there, you know.
That's under the public safety retirement, not under the Arizona State retirement.
They're all, I mean, it's...
Scott.
Mr. Mayor, if I can, it's been my privilege over the last year to serve as a League of Cities and Towns representative on a task force that was put together, the City Managers Association, the Finance Officers, and the League. And it's been an interesting journey. Our group has put together recommendations moving forward. Those were presented to the League Executive Committee a few weeks ago. There'll be an update at the League Conference this year. And we hope that a legislative the package of legislation will be presented in the next session. It's very optimistic to believe that we can start a new program on July 1st of 2016, but that's the plan. I'm delighted to report to you, as far as the unfunded liability of our two systems here at the town of Florence, both police and fire, one of them in terms of unfunded liability is about $500,000 to the bad. The other is about $500,000 to the good. So, but everybody, we all get older, and so that's the way it is today. But our situation here is not similar to what they're experiencing in Casa Grande and other places. But the fact is, system-wide, the unfunded liability is $4.6 billion with a B. So it's underway, and the work that the task force has done over the last year, Councilmember Hawkins, has been fascinating, and I think it presents the opportunity to really move forward in a positive way and at least stop the bleeding.
In other words, get it under control, right? I mean, the plan you guys are, whatever you've been going to, the meetings or whatever,
We can't do anything about what's gone in the past, but we certainly can what's going forward. And so certainly getting a new plan in place that's sustainable will allow all of our cities and towns, the PS, the school districts, everybody, not school districts, but the other public safety entities to deal with the unfunded liability. So the first step of a journey is getting a new system in place for July 1st, hopefully, of 2016.
Okay, well, that's all I was wondering.
It would be for everybody coming on board. It doesn't impact all folks that are on board already.
No, it's new. It really wouldn't make any difference for 20 years, but... we're planning ahead here. I mean, because those people wouldn't be retiring for 20 years. So, yeah. No, but then, yeah, the present employees would not be affected. Yeah, but I'm just saying, you know, I just keep reading in the paper. It seems like all the communities are in trouble. And as you said, the League of Cities and Towns have been putting the warning out there for quite some time that we need to get things under control.
Okay.
Thank you. That's all.
Are we through with the work session? Anybody have anything else on the budget that you want to talk?
I don't. I just wanted to say I misspoke when I said the dates because, Lisa, when we had talked before, we talked about the 22nd because that would be a normally scheduled work session day for town council to have that special meeting, not the 29th. So I did misspeak, and I wanted to make that clarification.
The only thing I would like to point out is if you go with the 22nd, between the turnaround time for having an agenda between the 18th and the 22nd would be dependent upon how much work it would be for Mr. Farina to be able to create the new documents. So that is a very short time window. Mr. Farina, are you comfortable with that time window?
That's 4 days.
As far as documents, you mean the budget document itself plus any RCAs and resolution?
It would be going from a work session on the 18th to all resolutions and everything being ready to set.
I believe based on everything that we've talked about, that may be a change. Coming from the upcoming work session, it doesn't seem like it'd be that much to make changes to get everything ready.
I will adjust that date to the 22nd.
Okay, thank you.
I was just going to ask a question about our budget books. You know, I want to keep what I have here until I get a replacement. Do I keep this book or?
You can have them.
Yeah, they're your books.
Okay.
Can you get that list out tomorrow?
I will have it out tomorrow. If you want to hang around 10 minutes, I'll have it out tonight.
Okay. Okay, that's it on the work session. We go call the council. John, you have anything else you want to say?
No, thank you.
Karen?
I'm good.
Becky? Bill?
I'm fine.
Valerie?
No.
Tara?
You know, I do want to say thanks to Becky and John for their time on the budget committee. It means a lot that you guys put forward that time and effort. And, you know, in looking into the future, the first year that I was able to serve on council, we all met together as a council to look at the budget. I really think in the future it would be beneficial if we could be there for those meetings, participate in those meetings as a council, as well as in a near future, look at, you know, what is the vision? You know, how has it changed? We have some new council members on here. What are our goals? What projects do we want to see done? And really take a look at that and come together as a council.
The only thing I'd like to say is thank you, department heads, for the job you've done helping with the budget committee. I appreciate everything that you've done. And keep up the good work. Live within our means. We'll have a good year. And start bringing Florence back up to where we get a nice rainy day fund, huh, Beck? Okay. Need a motion?
Make a motion to adjourn to executive session.
Second.
We have a motion and second to adjourn to executive session. All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Ladies and gentlemen, we will be in executive session and don't know how long it's going to be, but we will come back to adjourn.